let's see what, we'll just jump right in. So, as you guys know, our studies are focused on flour. So I know today you're going to hear a lot about all the wonderful derivatives that are coming out of cannabis flour, but our studies try to focus on actual dry bud material. So we're doing FDA controlled trials, trying to understand the medical benefits of smoked and vaporized flour. And our effort is to really try to put flour through the entire FDA drug development process. So we're doing nonprofit drug development research, and it's really difficult to find partners that want to do this, because you can imagine, most of these companies are focused on trying to isolate cannabinoids, things that they can actually patent and make money from, and we're the opposite. We're trying to basically keep flour in the nonprofit realm, because it can't be really patented easily, and we're doing that because we believe that flour certainly is the least expensive, because you don't have to do all the processing after. It's still the most popular. If you look at the data in all these legal states, people still migrate toward natural flour. We think that it will also, if we can get flour through the FDA process, I think it'll open most doors for other botanical medicines. Like, I work with MAPS, and many of you know they're a nonprofit that spearheads all this psychedelic research. And so for us, trying to pave the way for other plant-based medicines like psilocybin and ayahuasca and all these important potential medicines. So, and then of course the ultimate goal is to try to persuade health insurance companies to pay for flower the same way they pay for other pharmaceuticals, and that's why getting flower through the FDA process is so essential in order to achieve that goal of making insurance companies add that to their formularies. So many of you know we're probably best known for this clinical trial, but we do all sorts of different studies, which I'm going to talk about. But this study has been really crucial because, first thing, many of you probably don't know, we have not had a new drug on the market for PTSD in 18 years. Can you believe that? The first and only medicines that were approved were Zoloft and Paxil back 18 years ago. So nothing else has emerged. And all these other drugs that we use, physicians, we employ all these other drugs off-label. They've never been tested officially, formally for PTSD. But that's the challenge, is when you're treating PTSD, you're trying to attack this whole constellation of symptoms, right? They come in initially, they might report some insomnia, so you put them on some sleep meds. Then they report this depression, anxiety, you put them on SSRI or other antidepressants. And you can see how these guys just keep snowballing, and that's the way modern medicine is today. We have a different prescription that attacks each different target symptom. So these guys end up on, sometimes 10, 12 different prescriptions, all to treat PTSD. And so that's why we became so curious about the potential of cannabis, the idea that this complex plant and the pleiotropy that results from that, right, that the opportunity to target multiple organ systems in the body with this one intervention is so exciting to us. And that's why we embarked on this trial. But I wanted you to be aware that this study, even though we did finally complete it this year, it took us 10 years to get to the finish line. And that is the sad reality of trying to do clinical trials in the U.S. And if you dare say you want to study efficacy of cannabis, how effective is cannabis at treating a certain illness like this? Those studies get in almost into a permanent review process, typically, where they almost never emerge. And the only reason ours did was because we got so much media coverage along the way that pressured the government to help us, kind of hurdle these obstacles. And you can see, we ended up having this crazy saga, which many of you, we thank you so much for following us through this drama because it's insane. But, you know, we got fired from the university where we actually had IRB approval from the university to do the study. We were doing an FDA-approved, fully funded study, and they rejected us, terminated us. But this was a huge gift to our study because it ultimately we ended up, let me see if I can, but yeah, we ended up getting tons of media coverage and all these celebrities coming out of the woodwork to defend us. Like, you know, many of you know Andy Weil. He was one of my attendings at the university. He's a department chair of integrative medicine at the medical school at University of Arizona, and he wrote this public letter condemning his own university president for doing this. And so we're really grateful to have folks like him and, you know, John Oliver, all these folks coming out trying to help us because they realize how what this was really an attack on scientific freedom when they try to suppress this work. And so ultimately we ended up in our own private institute. And that's what I wanted to point out to you guys is that you can do this work totally independent from any university or hospital. We work through a private IRB system. We have no, you know, so then we're not beholden to the politics, the ugly politics in the university. It took me 7 years, though, to get this, what they call the, you know, the scientists call this the golden ticket, because it allows you the privilege of purchasing cannabis from our federal government. And so 7 years, I finally got the approval, ordered, you know, moved to order 8 kilos of cannabis, which was required for our study. And suddenly I'm thinking, you know, surely this would come by like armored truck or something, but there's the FedEx guy shows up at my door with, he has no idea he's even transporting cannabis. He's like, why all these cameras here? I was like, well, this is a really historic day. You know, we waited so long for this. But I was, you know, so disappointed to open up this cooler and see, you know, basically this was frozen cannabis sitting in the lockers of the research triangle, frozen for years. And you open up these sandwich bags, they have no information on them. They don't tell you anything except the CBD to THC ratio. So normally when I do clinical trials, I always get a drug master file that tells you all the properties of the study drug. No, not, there's zero transparency on that. You do not get access to the drug master file, despite us suing before, sending FOIA requests, all of that. So this is also another thing that handcuffs scientists because we have no idea what's really in it. And we have our own analytical a DEA license to do the analysis, but we decided we wanted to send it out to an independent lab so nobody would fault us for this. And you can see this is the material. This is pictures on the top from years ago. Many of you know Ethan Rousseau sent me these pictures of his study drug, and you can see how depressing this is, that this is the material. It's basically a concoction of stems, sticks, seeds, leaves, and some flowering, you know, flowering tops. But this is the most recent batch that we got on the bottom. So you can see what happened was we started criticizing the government about this, you know, all this extraneous plant material weighing down. Because remember, in clinical trials, you issue study drug to patients by weight. Right, so they may get 2 grams a day, 3 grams a day, but if half of the weight of the study drug is all of this junk and not the actual flowering part of the plant, then you see how that already sabotages your study from the beginning. So after all this criticism, they didn't like scientists criticizing their study drug, and they said, all right, we're going to grind it into a powder, so now you can't even discern what's in it. Very clever of our government, but we still know, you can still see all the fragments in there that show this is no better than, you know, Mexican ditchweed, really. But you can see, when we sent this out to these independent labs, we ended up finding excessively high levels of mold in all the batches. And we went back to NIDA and University of Mississippi and said, you know, what was your mold testing? Ours was over 100,000 CFU of mold in all the batches. And they said, oh, we've never tested for mold. And so I was like, wow, this is really, you know, mystifying that they've never thought, I mean, they're growing outdoors in Mississippi. It's like a formula, all the humidity there, it's a formula for growing mold. But they never tested for it, and only when we brought this to light, we shared our summary report. We, you know, we ended up doing three different rounds of independent testing, all showing sky-high levels of mold. And sadly, this is the only federally legal supply. So think about that, that every single study done in the U.S. that was looking at flour has been forced to use this lousy study drug. And I want to just give you some good news, though, is that so after 10 years, we finally got the 80th veteran through the clinical trial, right? So we screened almost 6,000 veterans for the study and finally found that 80 that met all the criteria. You can see there's just pages and pages of inclusion and exclusion criteria. But that's the binder for the 80th patient. We had only 4 dropouts in the study, which is a real testament to the, you know, resilience of these veterans. They just were so determined. They would never resign unless we forced them to. And we did have a couple patients that had some adverse events. But this is interesting, too, that the FDA still requires, you know, that binder is like 1,000 pages. And still, we have to do everything on paper, spend hours and hours transferring this to an electronic database. So you can see how laborious these trials are. But ultimately, sadly, I can't share the results of the veteran study yet because we haven't published all the data. We have unblinded everything, and we're pulling this into a manuscript now that hopefully will be submitted to JAMA later this year. But I can tell you that the results are exactly what you would expect from smoking moldy, diluted cannabis. I'm sad to say that I'm not sure people are going to be eager to read these results. So you'll see later, but I think that this is what spurred on. We've been trying to find a law firm to help us sue the DEA for years over this monopoly. And for those of you who aren't aware, you know, University of Mississippi has enjoyed a government-enforced monopoly for now, you know, since 1968. So that's 50 years that they have had the only Schedule I license as a bulk manufacturer. So every clinical trial that we or any scientists do, your all the universities at in California here, CMCR, UCSD, all these groups have been forced to buy this substandard plant material. Even though you're surrounded by some of the most beautiful flower in the world, you're buying that powder, that green powder. And so it makes me concerned. You know, Pierre just mentioned the National Academy of Science report, and we all know that that report only showed efficacy. You know, really, it said that there was only strong evidence to support cannabis for pain, nausea and vomiting, and spasticity of MS. But you think about all these other conditions that patients are reporting, they're getting benefit from, you know, everything from epilepsy to inflammatory bowel disease. Those studies, there was not scientific evidence to support their use. And that doesn't surprise any of us, right? Because we see what how these studies have been undermined by this low-quality study drug. We see how studies have been subverted by, you know, being forced into fixed dosing. That was one of the things I was most proud of in this trial that we just finished. This veterans study was the first one I'm aware of that the FDA allowed us to do patient self-titration, right? So these PTSD patients need to be able to adjust their own dose. You can't force them into taking, you know, 20 milligrams twice a day, whether they need it or not. That would be absurd, and that's what happens with these previous clinical trials is we've forced people and many times take way more than they need. Then they get tons of side effects that, you know, kind of eclipse any therapeutic benefit that we're able to document. So that's where I think these studies have gone wrong. Hopefully all the clinical trials going forward, if any of you out there are thinking about doing clinical trials, I would really urge you to keep on this train of patient self-titration, demand that your FDA, you know, the FDA was very oppositional with this idea initially. It took us months of back and forth with them before they finally embraced it. But believe me, their paradigm is established by Big Pharma, right? So that's what they know, is fixed dosing models. So we have to push them to rethink that paradigm and let us look at botanical medicine with a different paradigm now, that patient self-titration should be the rule of the day. And we've had, you know, many of the veterans in the study didn't even, you know, some days, you know how the PTSD fluctuates, right? Some days you are good, some days are bad. Some days they don't need any medicine. Other days they know, oh, I'm going to Walmart, I gotta pre-medicate, I know this is gonna be brutal. So that's the idea, is we wanna give patients the power to decide when they wanna medicate, how much they need. Some of these patients, you know, they were required to bring back their unused cannabis each week, so I would weigh what they used each day, and I could see that a lot of these patients only needed a few inhalations at night to help them initiate sleep, stay asleep all night, suppress their nightmares and flashbacks. They'd wake up in the morning feeling refreshed. They didn't even need often any study drug in the daytime. It was, you know, the nighttime dose was adequate. So that's the whole point, is give them the power to adjust the dose. So now I'm going to leave. I know we're probably short. Oh, I'm okay. Good. Okay. So I want to just explain to you what our next steps are. Because of the results of this veteran study, it spurred us on even further to demand a change from the DEA. And what many of you probably read, in 2016, the DEA announced that they were going to finally end the monopoly and license other growers for research. This was on the Federal Register, so it was a legit announcement. But since that, then 3 years later, they have not moved forward one inch toward doing this. They have, you know, 30 applications sitting on the desk of the DEA for 3 years that have not been processed. They took our application fee, $3,000. They processed my credit card, but not my application. So that's why we were so lucky to find this law firm that has no relationship to cannabis, by the way. They're people that just heard me speak at South by Southwest, and they were so outraged by this suppression of scientific freedom, and they said, you know what, we'll take this pro bono. They spent months researching this and submitted the petition. And it's actually not just against the DEA, but we're also targeting the Attorney General, whose office seems to be the primary culprit here. It's supposedly the DEA wanted to move forward, but the, you know, DOJ and Attorney General said, no, you're not to process those. So this is essential, though. This DEA monopoly is really the final barrier to doing legitimate cannabis clinical trials in the U.S., and it's held us back so much, because you can see the menu here is so limited. In our study, we basically got to look at high THC batch, a batch of high CBD flower, a batch of 1-to-1 THC to CBD, and placebo, and that's it. So that's the menu you've got, and yet here in the real world, patients obviously have access to thousands of phenotypes. We have a mountain of anecdotal evidence from patients that this is helping them, but that's the problem, is this is not bearing out in these clinical trials because of the, you know, the disappointing study drug, and the fixed dosing model is really harming the outcomes of these studies. So it's a real conundrum. It's like this catch-22, right? Because here we're trying to reform public policy. We need data in order to do that. Yes, there are thousands of controlled trials that have already been published in peer-reviewed journals alluding to the efficacy of cannabis for certain illnesses, but certainly not close to enough to persuade the medical community or health departments. We're all so snobbish about, you know, we need randomized controlled trials. That is the gold standard, and, you know, anything short of that is gonna, and that's the challenge with PTSD, right, is that PTSD, all the data so far has been conflicting. We have a ton of observational studies. Some have showed cannabis benefits PTSD. Some have shown it's harmful, that it makes patients aggressive, it promotes cannabis dependence. So there's all these reasons why people were hanging on this trial, hoping that this data would, you know, finally, the first randomized controlled trial in the world looking at this, thought finally we'd have a definitive answer. And so this is the challenge for all of you who are in this movement to try to keep the pressure on the DEA. The DEA has already received over a dozen letters, bipartisan letters from Congress, and they have not even felt the need to respond. It's amazing. The DEA feels, you know, apparently they're not accountable to anybody because they don't even respond to letters from Congress, not even a form letter. So I was pretty amazed by that, and that's why we move forward with the litigation, because we realize we can't wait on them to act. You know, we've heard references from the new Attorney General Barr saying, oh, we're going to get on that now, we're going to do something, but we all know that all these bills are just stagnating, waiting for, you know, I don't know what they're waiting for. I feel like nobody's interested in solving the problem. So hopefully we'll find a sympathetic judge. But in the meantime, I wanted to point out, this is actually a two-front war we're creating here. The one front is this litigation against the DEA. The second front is this opportunity, which is importing cannabis from a foreign country. So our government seems to have no problem with U.S. scientists sourcing cannabis from other countries. They just don't want any other domestic manufacturers. So here's what we're doing is, if we can bring in flower from Canada, as soon as the Canadian LPs prove that they have GMP-grade flower, then I will have the green light to import their flower, and that will finally break this monopoly. Because you'll notice, many of you have read how UCSD is importing they're importing cannabis oil from Tilray for that tremor study. That, just be aware that oil, cannabis oil, there's no monopoly around cannabis oil. That was broken years ago, remember, but when GW was allowed to bring in Sativex for clinical trials. So that monopoly ended years ago. The monopoly that exists is just around flower right now. They have not allowed any flower to enter the U.S. externally. They're not allowing any other domestic growers. So this is our hope, is this trial was supposed to be, I wanted to just point out something interesting here. So we're looking at late stage cancer patients, right? And we're going to evaluate, this is one looking at quality of life. The second study we're doing is looking at breakthrough pain. So we're going to be evaluating smoked cannabis flower compared to fentanyl, right? Because fentanyl, like the nuclear bomb of opioids, we use it so reflexively with our cancer patients. But the fact is that in a pilot study we did in Montreal, we found that smoked flower performed way better than fentanyl and just came on so quickly and patients got relief. So we're going to do this trial. We have FDA approval. The issue now is that the flower that I was preparing to import from this LP in Canada suddenly found the presence of 3 mycotoxins. So this is something I want to point out, is even these giant, this is a giant LP, multi-billion dollars, they have the financial resources to do the best industrial agriculture in the world, and yet they're not paying attention to the quality of their medicine. And so this study was supposed to start in January, and here we are. They still haven't been able to remediate the flower. So I just want to mention that this is the frustration for us as scientists. We are highly dependent on these groups because we're a nonprofit. We don't have money to pay for these studies. So we have to wait for them to do this. But I just want to say that, you know, some of these corporate behemoths are just so focused on the money play, and they forgot about the quality of the medicine and taking care of sick people. And it just makes me sad that we're in this state now where we're so dependent on this. But so I want to bring that up. And then my final slide, I just want to mention, there are all kinds of interesting things that come out that are generated through these trials. Even though we weren't studying opioid substitution in our study, and we weren't studying erectile function, But the veterans were reporting to us that both of those things were happening during the 3 months. And keep in mind, this is even with this really substandard plant material, that they were noticing that they weren't as reliant on their opioids. Many of them reported completely weaning off opioids during the course of this 3 months study. So that was exciting phenomena. And then this was the other thing, that we had so many young veterans coming in on Viagra, because that was, you know, that's what the VA does. They pummel you with all these psych meds that cause you to have no erectile function, and then they throw in some Viagra for good measure. And so it's, you can imagine how demoralized. These are like 30, 40-year-old veterans already on Viagra. They think their life is over. And so this was an exciting discovery, too, that many of the vets were noticing that they no longer needed the Viagra during the time where they were using the smoked flower. So that's what people are discovering, is that they need often a lot less cannabis than they thought. Even though typically in these studies we're giving them 2 or 3 grams a day just to give them enough to use what they need. But most of the time these patients are reporting needing less than 0.5 gram a day. And that just goes against that attitude from the prohibitionists that, oh, if you give them, you know, too much, that they'll just abuse it. The fact is, you know, sick patients just want to feel functional. They're not trying to get stoned. And I think we can, you know, these studies hopefully will dispel a lot of these myths. So I am actually really frustrated by, you know, this veteran study was actually supposed to randomize people into a smoking arm or a vaporizing arm. But we decided, we had an agreement from Tilray to do our vaporizer arm of the study and that they would fully fund it. That was 6 years ago. They still haven't finished the trial. They have like, I don't know, 2 or 4 patients enrolled, and it's just been a really anemic effort, and I'm really depressed about it because we would now be able to have data from both if they had finished. But again, this shows you they're happy to waive the trial in front of their investors and brag about how they're doing all this important research. But the fact is, when it comes to, they had a chance to be involved in this, it really, and Andrea can speak to this because she knows how tough it is. These big corporations are so dependent on shareholder satisfaction, and it's really hard, and they're constantly, you know, holding this up and waving it around it, but then when it comes to really executing, they don't do it. But I agree with you. The one thing that we heard from veterans was, and many of you in the audience can probably speak to this, and if you have time after, please come talk to me, because I keep hearing from people that they insist that smoking is just so much more robust. I'm, you know, typically I'm very anti-smoking in my internal medicine practice. It was really hard for me to embrace this initially, but I recognize this is a legitimate delivery method. The studies that we have, you know, 30 years of safety studies from NIDA still have not uncovered any long-term harms from smoking, no lung malignancy or emphysema. So I've embraced this, but I'm curious about why, you know, patients are talking about how vaporizing is good, but smoking is just a much more robust, and it seems to activate all these molecules in the plant that aren't, you know, normally activated by vaporizing, which only gets you to, whatever, 400 degrees. And so there's something in the combustion that takes it to another level for patients, and I think that's why it's still preferred by so many people, but not optimal when you're dealing with the medical community. So, two things. They do have to wash off cannabis for at least 2 weeks prior to starting the study, which screens out tons of patients right off the bat. If they're semi-dependent on it, they automatically walk away. But it was actually really helpful. Even people that were regular users found the drug holiday, you know, the two-week tolerance was beneficial, because it sort of helped resensitize their receptors. And so that's why even with this low quality cannabis from the government, they were getting some good responses because they were so sensitive to it, even though it was so diluted. So that's one thing. So they're not allowed to use any external cannabis, right? Once they enter the study, they're done with any, and we have ways of testing for that to make sure that they're only using ours. And then what happens is, oh, in terms of other so the other pharmaceuticals that patients were on, we asked them to maintain everything the same, right? So if they were already on a cadre of different as long as it wasn't things like steroids, stuff that would reduce inflammation, or chemo, things like that. But basically, if they were on psych meds, they were required to stay on whatever they were taking. If they were in psychotherapy, you know, getting cognitive behavioral therapy, they were required to stick with that throughout the trial, not change anything, because that could definitely confound our results. But that was the best way to do it. Otherwise, imagine if I was trying to take people off Paxil, Zoloft, you know, all these drugs that have such significant withdrawal. They, you know, if you try to take somebody off Effexor, they're in withdrawal for months after that, and that could really muddy the waters. So we asked people to just remain on exactly what they were taking. I'd say if there's one call to action I have for everybody today is, if you have connections with elected officials who care about this, we may be able to submit some amicus briefs, I guess it's called, where they could show their support that way, and maybe we could put pressure on the courts to acknowledge this. Because right now we have a commitment from Jared Polis, the governor in Colorado, has agreed to write an amicus, and also IAVA, the Iraq Afghanistan Veterans Association, they have agreed because they already have policy about this, and American Legion is also evaluating this for amicus support. So I'm hoping but we'd love to get other governors. We're trying to identify states where taxpayer dollars are going to fund trials using Mississippi cannabis. And certainly here you're in danger of that, because you have all new research money coming out, and anybody in your, you know, California universities that are buying, that are trying to do controlled trials, will be forced to buy the cannabis from Mississippi instead of using your own, you know, state licensed cannabis. So I think you guys have a real, your governor has a real basis to argue that we need to end this monopoly, so that you don't waste any taxpayer dollars studying this and getting lousy outcomes, you know. So if anybody knows Newsom or any of the other, you know, congressmen, certainly I think an amicus from a congressman's office could be valuable. So
thank you, Dr. Cicilli. That was amazing.